So the vision of this new urbanism has resulted in a return to the population to city center, in a gentrification of industrial areas, in the animation of street life, and more generally in a transformation of cities from a uniform space of work and transit into a mosaic of diverse neighborhoods, so that cities become like a collection of villages, each of which has its own identity, and people can really develop a sense of place with the neighborhood where they live. So now I want to turn in, to the ways in which narrative can be connected to physical space and how this can contribute to a sense of place. Reference to real-world entities is a distinctive feature of a genre that presents an ambiguous status with respect to the dichotomy between fiction and non-fiction, and this genre is a legend. In the modern world, to label a story a legend means that it didn't happen, that it is a fiction. But I think the difference between a legend and a myth is that legends concern objects that exist in real space instead of being about gods who live in a different world. And either legends concern real individuals, such as the saints, provided that the saints existed, or when it's concerned imaginary individuals, it put them in a real setting. And my example here, of course, is the legend of William Tell. We can say that the legend of William Tell creates a narrative map of Switzerland. So first, the first episode of the legend is, of course, the birth of William Tell, who it's in a small village that you can still visit. I don't know if you can see this house, but you can identify this village on a map. Then the second episode takes place on the main square of Altdorf, which is the capital of Canton Uri. That's where Gessler, the Austrian tyrant, made him shoot the apple on the head of his son. And he succeeded in doing so, but then the Austrians arrested him, and they took him across the lake to some unknown jail. But as they were crossing the lake, a huge storm broke out, and so they had to free him from his shackles so that he could row the boat to safety. And finally, when they arrived to the shore of the lake in the place that can you still visit in Switzerland called Telsplatte, so he jumped off the boat and he pushed it back in the lake, and so I guess the people on the boat drowned, but he was free. And then the next thing he did was to go around the lake. I don't know if he went up north or through the south, but he went to a location, I think it was in Schwyz, maybe it was in Lucerne, but where he knew that Gessler was going to ride through, and he waited for him, and when Gessler came through, he shot him with an arrow. And then the last episode, he had accomplished his mission, so he returned home and he died a heroic death trying to save a child. So in the story of Wilhelm Tell, you have an itinerary that takes him through each of the three cantons which who are at the origin of Switzerland. Switzerland was created in 1292 or 1291 rather, when three cantons signed a pact of mutual assistance. And so the itinerary of William Tell takes him through each of these cantons and cements the union of these cantons. So we are told by historians that William Tell, with the most famous Swiss of all time, that he never existed. But I remember as a kid how disappointed I was when I heard this very sad piece of news. It was almost as devastating as hearing that Santa Claus does not exist. So legends, in a sense, incite belief, or at least they are supposed to have incited belief in an older time. In an older time when the distinction between fiction and reality was not as absolute as it is today. And also if we think, for instance, of the legend of the Lorelei on the Rhine, we would love to think that it's what people in the old day believed. But actually, there were never anybody who believed this legend because it was created in the 19th century by a romantic poet such as Brentano and Heinrich Heine. But still, we think of legend as something that was once believed. But even when we do not believe legends, they single out certain landscape features and make them memorable, because nothing is easier to remember than a good tale. So without the legend of the Lorelei, I think this rock on the Rhine would be just another rock, but because of the legend, it becomes something very special that we remember. Now I want to turn to new form of connections between stories and real space, which have been made possible by digital technology. And one of them is, I cannot see the cursor. Oh, here it is. So one of these, this form of connection between stories and real topography is a website called Memory Maps. So on this website, you have users who take a picture from Google Earth and they put annotations. So this is a photo of a Scottish town, and it was annotated by a young man called Angus McDiarmid. And this is a collaborative project, so other people can add annotations. So there's this gentleman called Joe, who added some annotations. So he corrects some of the memories of his friend. But after a while, he decides, well, I have to do my own version of this. There are too many memories. The map itself is not big enough to contain the memories of more than one person because it is limited by what I call space two, the space of the medium. And you can see that the stories have to be rather small because they have to fit, if not in one of these squares, at least they shouldn't completely cover the map. So this is a medium for the kind of people that the philosopher Gideon Strawson has called episodics, people who experience life as a series of little stories, a series of anecdotes, rather than an overarching narrative that gives a global meaning to life. So this storyteller will use the map as a kind of mnemonic device. He looks at the map and that recalls stories about his childhood to his mind. So the map allows a different way of organizing your life than the standard chronological order that is typical of autobiography. Here you have a spatial organization. We tend to think of geographic maps as a complete and objective representation of space seen from a vertical perspective. But actually most maps, or probably all maps, serve a certain purpose, and they limit representation to certain categories of objects. That's why we have road maps, and we have hiking maps, and we have tourist maps, and we have military maps. So different maps show different aspects of the world. When you have an aerial photograph, it's much more objective because you cannot really remove a certain object. So the annotation of the storyteller do with respect to the photo what a graphic map does with respect to real space. It selects certain items as being worth of representation and it leaves other blank. So you can see that there are big areas of the map that don't have anything associated with them. And interestingly enough, there is even an area that it says, I don't know if you can read, Glenfield, pretty much terra incognita to me for some reason. So this area, what's special about it is that there are no stories associated with it. So the narrator has taken a non-place and he has turned it into a place because there's nothing about it. If we look at the organization of the map, it is organized around the church. You have the church, which is largely unvisited. And there's a school scene of innumerable triumphs and humiliations. So the church and the school are the centers of authority, but they are both regarded in a negative way. And around this center, the map represents all the mischief of the boys of the town. So it's a kind of stories that Max and Moritz would have told if they had access to digital technology. So here's an area. The bridge into the park, site of my worst crime of my childhood, which involved a group of boys, a classmate's forgotten school bag, and inviting waters of the Bum. The Bum is some kind of a swamp. So he doesn't really tell the story because there's not enough space, but he mentioned the three objects that are involved in the story, and we can reconstitute the story from this. He just threw his friend's school bag into the water. And then there is a site of the second worst crime of my childhood involving a carelessly thrown stone and a pane of glass. So he threw a stone and broke the window. And then he tries to claim that the stone had been deflected by the wind and he didn't intend to break the window. So here you have these minor crimes that kind of subvert the authority represented by the church and the school. On the outskirts of the town, there are some horror stories that take place, or some scary story at least. What happened to... I guess we have a technological failure. Anyway, here I have a reproduction. That's my insurance against technological failure. So here you have the horror story. That's where the gangsters lived and the people who were making fake money. How do you say? I've forgotten the word. And here, and my cursor has disappeared again. The second yellow square is where an old lady lives who used to shoot at the kids with a shotgun. And then in this green square, there was a horrible discovery, the discovery of the decaying corpse of a cow, and the kids kept it as a secret, and you had to be initiated into the society of the boys in order to be allowed to look at this decaying corpse of the cow. So this suggests that this is a secret geography. It's not a geography of the grown-ups. It's how the boys rewrite space by assigning certain meanings to certain places. And I'm sure that each of you in your childhood, you had the secret places that your parents didn't know about. A theme that runs through these annotated maps is how space has changed since the use of the writer. Like here he says, with an emphasis on a golden era of humankind, otherwise known as the mid to late 70s. Of course, that was the childhood of the narrator. So on another map, there is an annotation that said this is a place where we used to go sledding in the winter, but we cannot do it anymore because it used to be a golf course and now it's a condominium development. So the place has disappeared. This area received its meaning as place because you could go sledding, but this activity is no longer possible, so it's still space. You can still locate it on a map through GPS topography technology. So space is eternal, but place is transitory.